Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning on this beautiful day that God has given us. And in this time and place, we gather to have this service of the hanging of the greens, a way of preparing our sanctuary for the season that is before us and reminding ourselves of some of the symbolic meaning behind those greens that accompany this space and our homes. And I hope and pray that we all had good and blessed Thanksgiving times. And I wonder, are there other blessings from this past week to share? Any other blessings?
Blessings for our talented women who helped us make a beautiful angel.
Yes, blessings for Katrina and Joellen, our fiber artists who had this vision for angels, and blessings to all of us who got to add a stitch or two to help make them fly. We'll hear more about those later. Other blessings? Yes, singing Christmas carols yesterday afternoon with Bernie and Laura before the tree lighting and common lighting.
Blessings that my mom was able to leave rehab for 4 hours and come to our family Thanksgiving yesterday.
The blessings that your mom got to leave rehab and could spend Thanksgiving with family.
Yeah, we're not sure where she's coming home for sure, but at least she was able to get out for a little while.
That's wonderful. Laura.
Well, if all goes well, Bernie and I will have new titles as of May. We will be Grandma and Grandpa if all goes well.
Oh!
Thanksgiving, so we're really
what
grateful.
A wonderful blessing.
Even though this baby is growing in Germany, we're just going to be lifting them up in prayer, and we're so excited.
Oh, that's so wonderful to hear. Blessings on the whole family and in the time of expectation. What a great time of year to hear that news. So with those blessings shared and others that come to mind, may we always lift them up to God in gratitude. And may we now turn our hearts and our minds and our spirits to the worship of God.
The lighting of candles has been part of religious worship for centuries. As we light these candles in the chancel, we symbolize Christ's coming into the world. Jesus came to bring hope. Advent, which begins next week, is a time of expectation. And this is symbolized not only by the four-week period of preparation, we mark this time with the Advent wreath. On that wreath, 5 candles are arranged. During the season of Advent, 1 candle on the wreath is lit each Sunday as a part of our worship service. Each candle represents an aspect of spiritual preparation for the coming of Jesus Christ. The flame of each new candle reminds us, the worshipers, that something is happening and something more is still to come.
The blue candles symbolize the coming of Christ from the royal line of David. Traditionally, the 3 blue candles represent hope, peace, and love. The pink candle represents joy. The large white candle in the center of the wreath is known as the Christ candle and points to Jesus as the Christ, the light of the world. Purple or blue are colors used in churches for the Advent season. We choose to use blue here so that this season has its own color, distinct from Lent. While also a symbol of royalty, the blue hue used is similar to the color of the sky just before the dawning of new day's light. This is the season to remember the lights, which breaks the darkness of our world and our lives.
There is a candle in every soul. Some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home.
So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and torn. Hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle, go light your world. Carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the lonely, the tired and worn. Hold out your candle for all to see it. Take your candle, go light your world. Take your candle, go light your world.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. How shall we prepare this house for the coming of God's royal son? With branches of cedar, the tree of royalty. How shall we prepare this house for the coming of the eternal Christ? With garlands of pine and fir, whose leaves are ever living, ever green. How shall we prepare this house for the coming of our Savior? With sprigs of holly and ivy, telling of his passion, death, and resurrection. How shall we prepare our hearts for the coming of the Son of God? By hearing again the words of the prophets who foretold the saving work of God. Glory to God in the highest.
Glory to God.
Make your house
hope of all life, come to us this season. We are surrounded by your resources, yet we feel poor. In the company of your neighbors, we still feel lonely. With your gift of life, death still brings us grief. We are empty and need to be filled. Forgive us, great promise. Lead us into silence so that we may watch and listen and ponder the hope that we have in the promised coming of Jesus and all that his presence means.
Evergreens are shaped into a circle to signify the never-ending nature of God. The wreaths also signify the crown, both a sign of the reign of Christ and a reminder that for the love of us, Jesus wore a crown of thorns. Wreaths represent a love that knows no end. The love which came down at Christmas is eternal love. That story, God's story, our story, like the wreaths of Christmas, knows no end as it inspires and changes each of us again and again. The evergreens stand always ready to remind us of joyous hope. When all earth is brown, when the leaves have departed the trees, evergreens stand in lonely vigil against the earth again until the earth is green again. Evergreens have long been considered a symbol of eternity, as a sign of God's everlasting nature, and a sign that the faithful will experience endless life in fellowship with God in Jesus Christ. In Isaiah 60, verse 13, we find the words, "The glory of Lebanon shall come unto you, the cypress, the plane, and the pine, to beautify the place of your sanctuary."
Joy in our song, the last shall be first and the weak shall.
How many of us have our tree up? It's okay to admit it. Anybody have it up before Thanksgiving? It's okay. There's no rules. It's okay. When I put out the tree, when we, my family puts out the tree, of course, one of the things that happens, and maybe it happens in your family too, is that you begin to have stories and conversations and reminders about what each of the ornaments you pull out of a box means, the place you got it, the person who made it for you, the moment that it marks. From the silly to the ornate and beautiful, from the fun to the faithful, we adorn trees. And at least for our tree in our household, they can tell a story. They can tell a story of the moments and places of experience had and shared, of vacations and adventures, of gifts. One of the things I always cherished was the fact that growing up, my parents would always buy myself and my sister an ornament every year. So that on the day in which we left home and made our own home and our own trees, we had a collection of ornaments to put on our tree. And some of them still remain. And I cherish them greatly. And the stories they tell and the moments they remind me of growing up. Sometimes we talk about the expression, the tree of life. Well, maybe that's true of our Christmas trees. There's a sense in which they, if we really looked at them, and if people came into our homes and we were able to take an ornament and tell a story, it would tell something about our life as a child, our life as an adult, our life as a family, our life with our loved ones, our life experienced in so many places. So trees are a symbol for us this season, along with so many other things. A season in which we have, as a people of faith, laid upon the Christian story of the birth of Jesus into festivities and festivals that were already happening around the world, many around the harvest, many in preparation for long, dark winters, many against a prevalent narrative of Roman emperors who ruled, a way to subvert the system, to change the narrative. And so we have, as Christians throughout our history, borrowed and retold and reimagined those symbols that are around us that come from other experiences to help tell our story. So here now, a reminder of the symbol of the tree. In ancient times, the cedar was the tree of royalty. Today, we often use cedar, along with other greens like pine and fir or spruce and juniper, which we prize for their fragrance as well as their symbolism of our expectation and hope of the coming of the Christ child again. As we light our tree, we remember that Christ is ever present and that he is the tree of life. Though our trees are artificial, the shaping of the branches can also be a symbol, reminding us to shape ourselves, to straighten up, to be ready, to look ahead. For God is going to do something wonderful in the middle of our hearts and lives. And the small white lights that are used on our tree here, may they represent all of God's children and remind us that by working together, as do all of these lights, we hope and pray, we can shine as brightly as a light of Christ. At this time, I'm going to invite anyone who feels so moved while we sing O Christmas Tree to come forward and help decorate our trees. There are a couple of plates down here full of ornaments with words of faith upon them and I'm going to invite those who wish to come forward and add some ornaments to our trees.
We cannot hear the words of the prophets without thinking of the healing that the coming of Christ will bring. The evergreen most associated with healing in the ancient world was mistletoe, one time known as All Heal. Today it is remembered as the plant of peace. And I invite you to sit in that peace as Grayson brings forward the mistletoe. Originally, the kiss under the mistletoe was a kiss of peace. For when enemies happened to meet under the mistletoe in the forest, they threw down their arms and offered a friendly greeting. It is in keeping with these meanings that we decorate this place of worship with mistletoe in anticipation of the coming of the peace-filled and healing presence of Jesus the Christ. And in that spirit, will you stand? The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Share signs of peace with one another.
Dona nobis pacem, pacem. Dona nobis pacem. Dona nobis pacem. Oh,
The scripture reading for this morning is taken from the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 40, beginning with verse 1. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. The consistency is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades. When the breath of the Lord blows upon it, surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades. But the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice of strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. See, the Lord comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. Please join me for the word of God in scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God.
So as we get ready, we are reminded of the scriptures that invite us to get ready. For Christmas did not just come a long time ago. Christmas comes every year to us. It's not just a historical event, a birth long ago. It's a birth that keeps happening and greets us every year. It's a light that we are reminded of, that the darkness cannot overcome. It is the promise of a God who brings hope and peace and love and joy, and we're called to make way for that. We're called to add our voices as well as our decorations. We're called to share. For this coming Advent season, we will be hearing the stories of encounters with angels, those mysterious creatures those messengers of God. And so, as we come to listen for those voices as recorded in Scripture, we're also encouraged to hear those voices that speak to us here today. Angel voices, divine and heavenly voices, the voices of those around us, the voices that cry out for need, and how our voice and our hands and our feet and our hearts might help respond to their calls. For we are called to be bearers of the good news, just like those angels that are so part of the story of the season, bearers and declarers of good news. We come to a time to give thanks for all the ways in which we receive the good news. And as we hear these words from Scripture this morning, we know that God's promises came from long ago, and God's promises will come true. May we continue to listen for the promises, the hope. May we continue to live it out in our lives. Katrina and Joellen, who were the fiber artists who helped create our angels, offer this note. Bethany was the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. It was the place Jesus went to find rest and respite with his friends. Some scholars believe the name means house of the poor or house of the afflicted. Bethany was known to be a stopover for weary pilgrims on their way to Jerusalem. Bethany was where Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. It was where Mary sat at Rabbi Jesus' feet. It was where Jesus brought the disciples before riding into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. It was their lodging during Holy Week, and it was where the disciples gathered just before the risen Christ ascended to heaven. We imagined these angels as comforters. So rather than outstretched wings in flight, they have wings that enfold. Rather than trumpets of a clarion call, we have them with stringed instruments that soothe and charm. In these troubled times, the Bethany angels offer a gentle hope in ministries of kindness and healing, forgiveness and faith. May they grace your holy sanctuary with their loving presence. Katrina and Joellen, Magnificat liturgical artwork.
One doorway into the meaning and magnificence of Christmas is opened for us by, of all creatures, the angels. Angels are everywhere during the advent of Christ. The largest concentrations of angels anywhere in the Bible occurs right here, rebuking, informing, encouraging, guiding, protecting, and most of all, worshiping. The transformed vision of the ordinary folks going about their ordinary routines by revealing to them that the living God was in fact entering the world. The impact on those ordinary folks was profoundly life-changing. If we can see the incarnation through the angel's eyes, should we expect anything else? Now I invite you to stand and hold out your hands toward the angels as we bless them. The angels floating above us now, beautify our sanctuary for the season of Advent and Christmas. Envisioned by Katrina and Joellen, these hangings are a labor of their creativity and love for Emmanuel, God with us. to get these angels off the ground or out of the clouds required many hands. It was a blessing that so many in our Bethany faith community were able to gather and stitch them together.
As these angels help us worship with our eyes, may they open our minds, hearts, and hands to opportunities to praise God and herald the good news of Christmas. Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace among those who God favors.
Amen. Amen.
As we come to a time of prayer this morning, are there joys or concerns that we wish to hold up into prayer today, beyond those we shared at our time of blessing this morning? Elizabeth.
I ask your prayers for my husband, Tom, who will be having some significant oral surgery on Thursday.
For Tom, who will be facing oral surgery this week. Mary. Yes, for the people in Israel and Gaza and for the release of hostages and movement toward peace, somehow, some way.
Continue prayers of support for my mom and her family as we patiently wait to find out when she'll get to come home from rehab.
Prayers for support and encouragement as you wait with your mom on her journey back home from rehab.
Prayers for Jeff's aunt and uncle as they travel to Portugal next 2 weeks. So safe flights and they'll be there for till January. So the
traveling mercies for Jeremy's aunt and uncle as they travel to Portugal. Virginia. Prayers for Joanne's family as they mourn her loss.
Prayers for my coworker, Julie Holmes, who just lost his 1-month-old baby.
Prayers for your coworker as they mourn the passing of their 1-month-old. And may we be God's people at prayer, beginning first in silent conversation with our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. Gracious and loving God, as places around us become adorned with decorations and lights of things lasting, evergreen, things which tell stories and bring warmth and comfort, particularly in here in our neck of the woods, the darkest time of the year. May we be reminded of your presence with us, your spirit that broods around us and comforts us and encourages us, your light which shines before us, giving a pathway, more hope and more peace to more love and more joy. And especially in the times and moments and experiences where it seems very dark for a person, a place, a nation, a family, we pray for them and with them. That they may know your presence. For you are the God with us in all the ups and downs. You are the God behind everything, and you are the God leading us forward. You are the God of yesterday and today and tomorrow. As we embark on a journey towards Bethlehem, as we plan our holiday festivities and family gatherings, our gift giving and sharing, our celebrating, may we find times to pause and be still, to listen. Listen for messages to us, the echoes of angels from long ago that move us to more deeply care and share, to trust, to receive, and be open as servants of God, as heralds of good news. As our prayers rise to you this day, O God, and you hold them in your loving embrace, and those who are named in them. May we always be aware of signs of your peace, your grace, your constant companionship. So we humbly offer this prayer even as we are bold to pray, as Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, and forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Holly and ivy adorn our churches because, unlike most plants, they bear fruit in winter. Holly has been considered as the burning bush or symbol of Mary, whose being glows with the Holy Spirit. Holly has become a symbol of Christ's passion, with its prickly leaves representing the crown of thorns. The berries representing the blood he shed for us, and the bitter bark symbolizing the drink he was offered on the cross. Ivy is a symbol of our human weakness, clinging to divine strength. Remembering the one who is our strength, our source of life, and our source of new life, let us respond with an offering of our tithes, our pledges, and our gifts.
praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above the heavenly host. Creator Christ and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Dear God, receive our offering. Guide those who use it, that it may help to bring fullness of life to those who live in need and long for our care. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated for a few brief announcements, and then we'll get to our little town of Bethlehem. Changed it up a little this morning. I draw your attention to the announcements that are found in your service order, if you haven't seen them yet. A reminder that we're taking orders for poinsettias to adorn our chancel as we near Christmas. And the deadline for that is this coming Tuesday. We will be collecting the boxes for Harvest Hands Ministry. And they will be due back next week. There's still time to take a box and to fill one. And next Sunday, we will also be dedicating our pledges for 2024. Pledge cards were mailed out, and we would ask that people could get them back. We will be dedicating them during worship next week. Also, a reminder in the coming weeks of a few wonderful events. First, this coming Sunday, not this Sunday, but next Sunday. Bernie, do you want to say a little bit about the Ecumenical Christmas Concert?
Yes, so again, the Ecumenical Christmas Choir Concert will be held at the theater next Sunday. It starts at 6:30, and we'll have Bethany represented there with singers and music, and we will have a number of other faith communities in Foxborough, including the YMCA Glee Club. With some special people in that group. So it's a wonderful, fantastic opportunity to get our communities together, to sing together, and we'll have a reception here afterwards mm-hmm. in Fellowship Hall. So that's at 6:30. It's a free will offering. They're saying, you know, $8 donation if you can make it, but you do need to reserve a seat because it usually sells out. Hope to see you there.
If you didn't get there last year, it was a wonderful event. Please try to get there this year if your schedule allows. Again, go to MRPAC for reserving your tickets so they can make room for you. And tell your friends and your neighbors as we spread the word, not only amongst our faith communities, but the whole community as well. And then here, also, we will host once again the Christmas concert for the Neponset Choral Society the weekend after. So lots of things to sing, and to hear lots of singers in these coming weeks is always part of the season. Elizabeth, I know you wanted to talk a little bit about Advent bag.
So this year's Advent theme are angels in a bag, which will be available next Sunday out in the narthex. You can reserve yours by sending me an email, and I'll have your name on the bag. The fun things to do, an angel advent calendar, an angel advent wreath, of course, a recipe for baking, and some other fun things. So I hope you'll take a bag home and enjoy the angels throughout the season.
Great. And also an invitation coming up on December 13th. We will once again host a Blue Christmas service. This, as you read about it, is where we carve out some time and space, particularly for those who are feeling loss or hurt or pain, sadness or loneliness in this season, uncertainty. It's a space to be together in silence and to just be still and feel the loving presence of God and the promise of the light that the darkness can never overcome. It's also a time that even if we're not going through a difficult moment, to come and pray in solidarity with and for those we know and love and throughout the world who might be feeling a little more blue this Christmas. The cross and the nativity. In the season of Advent, we recall how the faithful in ages past waited for God. God came to us in an unexpected way as a baby born in a lowly manger. Jesus grew up to be a teacher, healer, prophet, and savior. He loved us so much that he eventually died on a cross. Even the cross couldn't end God's love for us. Our cross is empty because Christ lives. God's never-ending love brings with it the promise of never-ending life. So let us remember that it is because of Easter that we celebrate Christmas. The nativity scene speaks to the mystery of God's wisdom. Why God chose to send his son into our world as a baby of humble birth, born in common surroundings, we do not know. What we do know is that God reached out to all people, including the poor and wealthy, the simple and the wise, the powerless and the powerful. The manger will remain empty while we await Christmas. But we will journey and gather with Mary and Joseph, with shepherds and wise ones, overwhelmed by God's greatest gift. So we are invited to join in singing O Little Town of Bethlehem, which is found as number 155 in the hymnal. And I would invite some folks to come forward to help place our nativity figurines up here on the chancel, a beautiful set shared with us by the France family.
Oh,
And as we journey out into the world that feels dark and close and worrisome, we take with us the unchanging light of Christ that will always shine in the darkness.
Siblings in Christ, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each one of us, now and forevermore. And let God's people say, Amen. Amen.
The desert and the parched land, the river joys and blue, blooming with God's flowers, His life rejoicing with song. The glory of God's love will be given unto them. They will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. The hands of the feeble, make firm the knees that are weak, say to hearts that are frightened, be strong, fear not, here is your God. And He's coming for you.
Ooh, He's coming for you.
Streams will be in the desert and rivers in the steppe, burning sand and out pools of water, the Lord will bring His people peace. Drink of His peace.
Ooh,
the drink of His peace. The Lord is ransomed, will return on the day, and enter Zion singing, crowned with everlasting joy. Sorrow will flee, sorrow will flee. Have no fear in the desert, have no fear in the night. I, the Lord, am with you, with strength, with hope, I am your God. My freedom is yours.
Ooh, yeah, my freedom is yours.
The blind shall see, and the deaf shall hear. The lame shall walk, and we all will see. The blind shall see, and the deaf shall hear. The lame shall walk, and we all. To the Lord.